The Financial Survival Network, helping you to survive and thrive in the new economy.
This is the Financial Survival Network.
Financial Survival Network is presented to you by Regal Assets. Buy and sell physical gold and silver through your existing retirement plan 100% tax-free with Regal Assets. If you want to include physical gold or silver in your existing IRA or old 401k, request your free investment kit, which was recently featured in the Forbes and Smart Money Wall Street Journal magazines. Call toll-free 855-678-6620, 855-678-6620, or visit regalassets.com.
Hi, it's Kerry Lutz. The person I'm about to introduce you to is on my bucket list of global financial luminaries who are always out ahead of the pack. In fact, they're often leading them to the next financial bonanza. Jimmy Rogers, global financier, citizen of the world, author of the popular book, A Gift to My Children, is here with us now. And Jimmy, welcome to the Financial Survival Network. We're so honored to have you.
I am delighted to be here, Kerry.
So you're back stateside now, right?
I'm here for three or four days, yes, and then I'm back on another overnight flight to Singapore.
Singapore Airlines, my favorite airline.
mine too.
How long has it been since you were here last?
Oh, actually, I was here a couple of weeks ago. I forget why now. I do so much time, travel time, but I was in the U.S. Two or three weeks ago. I don't get here as much as perhaps I could or should, but at least three or four, five times a year I get to the U.S.
And in your trips back, are you noticing many changes?
Oh, yeah. I mean, Kerry, you fly into JFK and you know you're in a third world airport. used to be that it was the top of the league, or that then New York was. You get in a third world taxi and you ride on third world roads, and you, even if you go to a five-star hotel in New York, it's a five-star third world hotel. No, it's that unfortunately our standard of living and our standards have declined a lot in the 5 years I've been gone, much less in the past 10, 20 years.
Yeah, it's really a sad commentary, because the U.S. pretty much invented air travel, invented the concept of commercial airlines and airports, and yet so much of the world has passed the United States by. You've had such a long, illustrious career, and a lot of people really look up to you as somebody who's recognized trends, somebody who's really gone around the world to really understand what's happening on the globe. But as many public people, you have things that you're more proud of than anyone really thinks about. With you, what would be the thing that you're most proud of in what you've accomplished in your career and your life?
Well, if you asked me here in 2012, I would tell you it's my two little girls. I didn't have children. I used to never want children, Kerry. I thought children were a terrible waste of time, energy, money. I felt sorry for my friends who had children. I was never going to do anything so foolish. Well, I want you to know I was totally wrong, unbelievably 100% wrong. I cannot tell you how excited and proud I am of these two little girls. So if you ask me today, I would say it's two little girls who were born in 2003 and 2008.
That's pretty amazing the way you think you know a lot, you think you've been through a lot, and then you have some children, and all of a sudden you realize, wow, you know, I don't really know quite as much about life as I thought I did.
Well, it certainly happened to me, too. Kerry, I would say if there's anybody listening or watching this who hasn't had children, I would urge them to get home and get on with it. Don't take a day off these days, but go home for lunch. I mean, you know, take a lunch hour. It's really a lot of fun.
Some of us think that it's more fun to create them than to actually raise them, but I've been blessed myself, so I'll leave that to others. But, you know, you've traveled around the world before you were thus burdened, and at one time you biked around the world, which I think you got into the Guinness Book of World Records for. That experience, what did it do for you?
Well, first of all, it got a long-time dream out of my system. I'd been wanting to go around the world by motorcycle for probably at least 15 or 20 years at that point. I did it. It didn't get it out of my system, however, because then I wanted to go again. So I went again 10 years later, only in a car this time. But it was a great, wonderful experience. I certainly learned a lot about myself, about the world. nothing like crossing a border in the wilderness rather than in an international airport.
Yeah, I bet they looked at you really strange in a lot of those far out places, didn't they?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Most of them had never seen, many of them had never seen Americans. Many of them had never, certainly never seen motorcycles like that. I mean, it was just standard off-the-rack BMW motorcycles, but in some places, they might as well have been spaceships.
And what was, like, the weirdest thing that happened to you on that trip that you'll never forget?
Well, I guess the first thing that pops to mind, and there were many, I guess the first thing was being held hostage for 9 days in the Congo. They wanted money, needless to say. We finally convinced them we didn't have any money. We were just poor motorcycle travelers. But that was unique.
So a little scary because you didn't know if you were going to get out or not?
Well, yeah, whenever you're held hostage for a long time, and we were being held hostage by the police, which made it even more worrisome because, you know, who are we going to turn to? If we escaped, we couldn't go to the police because the police were holding us hostage. So, yeah, it was worrisome.
You know, you understand, like, one time I got arrested for speeding in Massachusetts, of all places, and, you know, the guy didn't like me because I was from New York, and threw me in a cell. And I said, gee, you know, well, my girlfriend's there, so at least people will know I'm here. But then you hear about that guy, the DEA left him in a cell for 5 days with nothing and almost killed the guy. He was just kind of in the wrong place at the wrong time. So I guess you learn a lot about government power when you go to these different countries and you see and you encounter things like in the Congo of being held for ransom, literally.
Well, Kerry, it's not, as you just pointed out, it's not just other countries. It happens in the United States, too. You mentioned an example. Well, there are hundreds of examples like that, not specifically like that, but where innocent people get put in jail and they either suffer the consequences or some of them eventually get out. No, it happens here, too. It happens here big time.
Yeah, it's something that we really don't like to think of because we have this constitution. You think you're protected by it. You think you have rights. And then all too often, especially in modern-day America, something happens that really destroys your confidence in the system and makes you realize that it's not as wonderful and the things you believed aren't really true.
Well, Kerry, first I want to say your comments about the constitution were certainly legitimate up until 10 or 12 years ago. In the past 10 or 12 years, as recently as December, you know, they're passing all sorts of laws. They could drop a drone on your house right now, and there's nothing you could do about it. Obviously, you'd be dead, but nothing anybody else could. They don't have to have a judge. They don't even have to go to the police. They just have to have a secret committee say, that guy Kerry is dangerous, and they can murder you. They can go into your bedroom, into your garage, into your bank account. They can do anything they want to now. So all of those freedoms that we once upon a time had are long. I don't like saying this. I'm an American just like you. But don't rely on the Constitution so much anymore unless we get a Supreme Court which is going to throw all this stuff out, which doesn't look likely.
In all your world travels, right now you're living in Singapore. Where would be the second place that you would choose to live if it wasn't there?
My second best place to live? Well, the situation here is I mainly want to live in a Chinese-speaking city because of my children. They speak Chinese. I want them to continue to speak Chinese. So that limits it somewhat. Part of the problem is the great Chinese-speaking cities such as Hong Kong, Shanghai, are all horribly polluted, terribly polluted. Maybe Vancouver. Vancouver's got a huge Chinese population now. It's an exciting city. Maybe Myanmar. Myanmar is very exciting, what's happening there. It's opening up. It's the same place China was 34 years ago, and I could probably find some Chinese there. There are many great opportunities in the world and many exciting cities in the world, but I am a little bit constrained because I want my children to continue to speak Mandarin.
Yeah, that definitely makes a lot of sense. I've tried to talk my kids into it, but they're not hearing any of it. And funny, you talk about predator drones. I was flying down to Florida from New York couple of weeks back, and I like to look out the window, and between South Carolina and Georgia, I look out, and there's a predator drone patrolling the coast, and it really brought it all home that there is no limitation on what the government can do to you and what the powers for them to do anything. It's totally changed, you're right, in that last 10 or 12 years. for English-speaking people, for Americans who aren't fluent in other languages, the choice, if they want to expatriate, it's a difficult one, isn't it?
Oh, well, it's always difficult to expatriate from any country. But remember, Carrie, everybody in this country, nearly everybody in this country, is a result of somebody expatriating once at a time. And history obviously shows that the people who do immigrate are not usually, always, ambitious, smart, motivated, driven people. Other people don't get up and move. It's very, very difficult to get up and leave your country and everything you know, including the language. So no, but it's good for the world. Immigration is. It made America. It made many great cities and countries in the world because new blood, new energy, new brains, new capital is always good.
In a way, the people that expatriate are the ultimate risk takers because they're willing not just to leave behind their families often and other things, but they leave behind a culture and go to a strange culture that they really, regardless of what you read in the books, you don't really comprehend it until you're there. And then the adaptability of the human species really comes into play. We were made to adapt. We weren't made for this stable environment where everything works like a Swiss watch. And I think that's something in this era of stability we've had over the post-World War II era, the appearance of it, that's something people are having a lot of trouble adjusting to, these unstable times, aren't they?
Well, actually, if you go back in history, Carrie, all times have been unstable or instable, as you put it. You pick any year in history and then look at the world 10 or 15 years later, and you will see that the world has changed dramatically. Look at 1900 and then look at 1915. Or look at 1925, and then look at 1935. You know, you pick the year, and then look at the world 10 or 15 years later, and it's astounding. Look at the last, what is this, 2012? Look at the world in 1997, and how it's changed, how much has happened. Look at it in 2002, 2001. Look at 2001 compared to today. No, this concept that the world is always stable, and we can look ahead and understand what's going to happen. History does not bear that out. You pick any year and then look ahead 10 or 15 years later, and whatever people thought changed dramatically throughout the world. And in some countries, it changed even more than dramatically. I mean, it changed, you know, beyond comprehension for some people. Your country collapsed. It was really a great change.
Obviously, you know, it's an illusion of stability because we're living it, so it appears to be the norm, and it's only when you look back that you say, like Steve Jobs' commencement speech at Stanford, where he says, looking back, you can connect the dots. When you're living it, you can't connect the dots. And we see that so often. But right now, people are looking into the future because the loss of confidence in the world financial system, in the U.S., Europe, and the emergence of Asia, but Asia's going through growing pains now too. Where is that going to leave us here? What is the financial system going to look like? Your best guess, and how do we adapt to it and actually meet it there rather than trying to play catch up?
Well, the financial system, I presume you mean in the U.S. or maybe even the West, is going through a dramatic change. This too has always happened, Carrie. When I went into Wall Street in the mid-60s, Wall Street was a backwater, was a wasteland. Very few people went there. In the 50s, 60s, and 70s, only the idiot son went to Wall Street, which is why I went. I mean, it was nothing. Wall Street was 3 million with an M shares. I mean, now they do that before the market. They do that right after midnight because the markets around the world are already trading and open. So Wall Street became a huge boom in the 80s and 90s, but that's finished as far as I'm concerned. You know, now we're in a period of decline again. Well, the financial system is going to be like it was in that previous 30 years or 40 years, and it's going to be a wasteland again in the next few years. Right now, there's huge competition. In 1958, America produced 5,000 MBAs. The rest of the world produced none. Last year, we produced over 200,000 MBAs, and the worst of the world produced thousands more. Huge leverage now in the financial system, which there wasn't before. And, of course, governments everywhere are coming down hard with regulations, taxes, controls. Nobody likes bankers anymore. Politicians love to blame somebody else for their failures.
Oh, yeah.
Blaming the financial system. So finance is going to be a terrible place to be in the next 10, 20, 30 years. The producers of real goods are going to be the ones who are rich and masters of the universe, but not us, not in the financial community. Some who love it will do extremely well, but I happen to adore what I was. I would have done it for nothing if I could have afforded it. Unless you can have that kind of attitude towards finance, you better do something else.
Hey, and you raised one of the best points and why I think talking to you really is such an honor, because you followed your passions, all of them, and you did what you wanted to do. You weren't necessarily pursuing major wealth. You were pursuing a passion. And isn't that the best advice to somebody who's getting out of college now or thinking about going to college and going into HOC, $100,000, $200,000, find that passion?
You have to go into HOC more than $200,000. You know, go to Princeton will cost you $300,000 these days. So, yeah, I give $100,000 to $200,000, unless you're going to a state school or something, is not very realistic anymore. But that's the best advice for anybody, especially college graduates, but anybody. You follow your passion. That's the only way you're going to be successful, Carrie. You have to follow what you love. You're not going to be successful, terribly successful, if you don't love what you're doing. And the people who love what they're doing never go to work. They get up every morning, start having fun, and they make a lot. And they usually make a lot of money because they're having so much fun. But even if they don't make a lot of money, they're never unhappy. They're the happiest people in the world, and they usually are very successful as well.
Yeah, and just a personal note, you know, I had five other careers before I started radio, before I started media, and it's the only time where I haven't had a job that I have been happy with everything. I walk up the stairs to my office, and I float in the morning, and it's dark outside. I don't even know what time it is. My wife's upset with me because I'm late for dinner, and I float down the stairs, and I don't know where the day went, and I enjoyed every second of it. And if it's any advice to give a young person, it's follow the passion and not the dollar or the gold or the silver or whatever, right?
Well, Carrie, the dollar will come if you follow your passion. You should never take a job because of the money. You should take a job because it's the right job. The money will follow. The money will always follow if you're at the right place.
Yeah. Unfortunately, young people are impatient. That's something that goes away with age. And they want to be rich now, so they take shortcuts. I know I did it, and I wound up in a bunch of meaningless careers doing stuff like, without getting into it, legal printing, buying and selling distressed assets, and there was never a point where I felt like I was really realizing my potential until this moment. And to me, that's the best lesson that you give is you never compromised. You always did what you wanted to do, and what could be better in life than that?
Well, I wasn't smart enough, I guess. I wasn't smart enough to do the wrong thing. I was pretty simple-minded and just wanted to do what I wanted to do. So that's what I've done.
Yeah, well, that's why growing up in the South when you did wasn't such a bad thing, perhaps in retrospect, huh?
Or since this is Mother's Day, I mean, we're recording this on Mother's Day. Maybe it's because of my mother, my parents.
Oh, absolutely.
Something happened. I suspect it's more my parents than anything else.
Yeah, it's values. You know, you transfer your values generation to generation. And of course, you know that anybody listening right now wants to know your take on the financial markets, on what's going on in precious metals. So just briefly tell us your viewpoints, what's going on now, the decline in prices and the euro and the dollar and all that.
All that's going to take
all that stuff.
That's two or three days, right? I will tell you briefly that I own precious metals, including gold and silver. I'm not buying gold and silver now. Gold has been up 11 years in a row, which is very unusual, Carrie, for any asset, any time in history. It has been consolidating since September. I suspect that consolidation is not over yet. It wouldn't surprise me if gold were down in 2012. It would probably be good for gold and all of us who own it, if it were down in 2012, because then it would scare a lot of people out, and we could start over from a sounder base. how low it goes, I don't have a clue. If it went down 40%, I guess that would be around 1,200 or so. You know, a 40% correction is the norm in markets. Most assets go down 30 or 40% in any year. It's just, if you look at the fluctuations of the high and low on any stock on the New York Stock Exchange, it's usually a 30% or 40% difference there. So that would be a normal thing, and it would scare a lot of people out. It happened in the 70s in one of the great bull markets of all time. In fact, gold went down 50% during that great bull market, scared people to death. So to make a long story short, I own gold and silver. I'm not selling gold and silver. I'm a little bit hedged in both, not completely hedged. But if it goes down much more, I hope I'm smart enough to buy a lot more. Gold is going up. They're both going much, much higher.
Right. I remember you talking about going back to farming because the world's going to need a lot more food, agricultural commodities, and energy. All those things are pretty much set for the long trend, aren't they?
Well, we have a shortage of everything. The International Energy Agency is trying to explain to people that our known reserves of oil are in steady decline. Same with mining. And there's been only one lead mine opened in 25 or 30 years. The last lead smelter built in America was built in 1969. That's 43 years ago. I mean, we have huge shortages developing in agriculture. The inventories are near historic lows now. But, Kerry, the average age of a farmer in America is 58. In Australia, it's 58. In Japan, it's 66. In Canada, it's the oldest they've ever been, the farming population, all over the world. Nobody's becoming farmers. So it's not just this year's crop or last year's inventories. We don't have any farmers. And the price of food has to go much, much, much higher if we're going to attract labor, management, capital to agriculture, unless something happens big.
I have a question about that in particular. We've seen this large-scale agribiz develop in the U.S., in the Western world, where it's just pure quantity, we're not talking quality, and it's a factory. What about the trend there? Is that going to go back to the family farmer, to where farming was a craft as well as a science, or are we stuck with this agribiz?
No, there's going to be many opportunities for everybody in agriculture coming forward. There are going to be times, there are going to be opportunities for the family farm, if you will. There's going to be opportunities for the efficient agribiz, if you will. If I'm right about what's about to happen to agriculture, anybody who has anything to do with agriculture has fabulous opportunities. And if you don't want to be a farmer, Kerry, you can sell seeds or fertilizer or tractors or open shops in the farm belt. You know, there are many, many ways to get the Lamborghini dealership in Iowa. There are going to be many ways to make money going forward as agriculture develops and booms.
Yeah, and at least in Iowa, they have flat, straight roads, and you can actually have some fun with that Lambo, unlike in New York City, where you're hitting potholes that'll cause $50,000 worth of damage, and God forbid, you go over 65 miles an hour, and you'll have a cop on your tail and a helicopter, you know, a black helicopter following you until you pull over.
or until they drop a drone on your Lamborghini.
Which is always a possibility. So I like the concept of getting the Lamborghini and the Ferrari and the Maserati dealerships in Iowa. Sounds like a good move. One final question. The U.S. dollar, is it doomed? Do we go back on a gold standard or a fixed money supply of some sort?
Well, yes and no. The dollar is doomed over the long term. I happen to own the dollar at the moment, Kerry, because everybody's been so pessimistic, and there's turmoil in other currencies in other parts of the world. And rightly or wrong, well, actually wrongly, but people do rush to the U.S. dollar as a safe haven. It's not a safe haven.
Old habits die hard.
Yeah, but I cannot tell the rest of the world not to run into the dollar, so I own the U.S. dollar at the moment. I don't know how long I will own it because it's a terribly flawed currency. We're the largest debtor nation in the history of the world now, Kerry, and we're going to have huge problems in the dollar going forward. At the moment, I do happen to own it because it looks as though there's going to be more turmoil there. So the the currency markets offer great opportunities because we have such huge imbalances, historic imbalances. The creditor nations, the largest creditor nations in the world are China, Korea, Japan, Taiwan. You know who the debtors are and where they are. So these imbalances are going to be worked out in the currency markets. The gold, maybe we will yank back to the gold standard. If things collapse next week, people will be desperate and they won't know anything else to do. But I hasten to tell you, the gold standard has many flaws, has never worked either in the long term. People have always abandoned it, mainly because politicians find ways around the discipline of the gold standard. They cheat on the gold standard. So it, too, has flaws. The best solution, in my view, is one of competing currencies. Let people use what they want. But that's unlikely because politicians like to have monopoly control of money.
The only reason why I really look at the gold standard, and it was flawed, and we always had inflation in the U.S. whenever, from the War of 1812 on, when we went off to fight a war, we had inflation guaranteed. But when the world was on a gold standard, you generally only had one bubble at a time. And now with the fiat currencies, because they're not limited in the quantity that they can produce, we have multiple bubbles, realestate.com, and the bubbles just keep coming and coming. And eventually one of those bubbles is just going to, you know, now we have the derivatives blowing up with the large banks, which have been determined by the powers that be to be too big to fail. And if they had to be on a gold standard, it couldn't have happened.
Well, also, more important than that, if they hadn't bailed all these guys out, if they, starting back in, 94 or even 98, if they hadn't bailed out Wall Street, Lehman Brothers and Bear Stearns would still be in business because they would have lost so, everybody would have lost so much money. They would have had impaired balance sheets. They would have had to fire a lot of incompetent people. A and B, they wouldn't have been, they wouldn't have had the money or even the nerve to do a lot of crazy things.
Yeah.
Every Mellon Greenspan got a phone call to save me. He pumped the system up. If they keep bailing everybody out, nobody's ever lost any serious money or any permanent money. And they keep hiring and letting all these incompetent people do whatever they want. That would be the best solution, in my view, the market. The market would take care of these people, but the government won't let the market work. You advocate the gold standard. As I say, it has worked for at least some short periods in history, but it too has, in the end, had problems. I'm much more of an advocate of the market, let the market clean out these guys without artificial constraints.
Yeah, it's a nice thought, and people go back to this Glass-Steagall thing. Well, Glass-Steagall also brought us the FDIC, which basically created the carefree depositor where one bank was as good as another because the U.S. government's going to take care of me. So true deregulation where people have to understand that the guy at the desk behind the cage holds their financial life in his hands, and if he doesn't do it right or he has a bad gambling habit, whether it's on Wall Street or Las Vegas, he's going to be held to account. His wealth's going to go down with it, but we're so far from that that only the next disaster can kind of get us back there again. But anyway, I want to thank you again for coming on the Financial Survival Network. It's really been an honor and a pleasure. Enjoy the rest of your stay in the States.
Thank you, Gary. I hope look forward to seeing you again sometime. It's been my honor and my pleasure.